Good afternoon. Hope your day is going well. Hope you've had a good day today, and I hope everybody's still doing well. Continue, as always, to pray for one another, pray for our nation, pray for those on the front lines as we battle this virus. We're praying that it'll be over soon. We can get back together soon, and just look forward to that time together. Have a couple of announcements I want to just let everybody know about. If you go to our church website, pgbcsc.com/Awana, you'll find some information there about our Nobody Loves You More Than Jesus Easter Egg Challenge. And there's a lot of information there. Please read it carefully and look over that. It began on Monday, and it'll go through this Saturday. So if you haven't participated yet, we'd love for you to. There are some things there that you'll need to read. So go on our website, find that, and it ends Saturday night at 7 p.m. So we're looking forward to the outcome, and just hope you're having a good time doing this challenge. So again, it's on our website. You can check that out. Also, if you've missed any of our messages, I just want to remind you, our church's YouTube channel, you can find all of the messages there. So if you've missed any, we'd love for you to go there and check out the messages. You can even subscribe, and it'll give you a notification when new messages are posted. So don't forget about that. Also, continue, if you will, to pray for Miss Carolyn. We want to ask you to lift her and her family up in this time and just ask the Lord to be with them and just comfort them and help them in this time. So we ask you to pray for them in a special way. I want to have a word of prayer, and then I want to go ahead and read scripture tonight, and then we'll begin our lesson. So let's pray together first. Father, we thank you for the privilege to come together, Lord, tonight. We thank you for your word, and Lord, we just ask you tonight that you might speak to us again. Lord, we understand that, Lord, we can't be together right now, but Lord, we can be together in one spirit, Lord, and we can be together as the family of God, Lord, through various avenues and ministries. Thank you, Lord, for the times that we've been able to talk over the phone and, Lord, fellowship together that way. Lord, we just pray that you continue, Lord, to heal our land of this virus. We pray, Lord, that you would continue, Lord, to heal those who are sick. Continue, Lord, to protect those on the front lines and those who are battling, Lord, and Lord, just seeking a vaccine and all the things going on. We pray for your wisdom and your discernment and your guidance in these areas. Lord, we pray that, Lord, that we might turn to you, that, Lord, our nation might turn to you, that many might be, Lord, focus their hearts and their lives upon you. And so, Lord, we thank you for this time that we can just be still, that we can trust you, that we can lean upon you, that, Lord, we can just hear from you. So, Lord, tonight we ask you, speak to us now from your word and have your will and way in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're so thankful that we could gather. We even have a congregation here tonight. I'm thankful that our creative ministries, our puppet team, could join us tonight. And so they are practicing social distancing. There might be one couple down front being disobedient, but that's one home together. So there are others. They're all about 6 feet apart tonight. So we're glad they could join us. A few have their hands up. Most of them are smiling. Some of them look like they want to say amen. If they do, I might run. But we thank the Lord for them being with us tonight. Want to say thank you to Mr. Phillip and Miss Brenda Kirkland for doing that. Such an encouragement. Thank you, guys. We love y'all. If you have your Bible with you, or wherever you may be tonight, I want to invite you to turn with me to Deuteronomy chapter 6, and we're going to read 9 verses tonight. I quoted a couple of these verses in a previous message, but want to go back tonight and encourage you tonight as we think about healthy homes, and as we look back at the time that God has given us in our homes together, and I want to just look at this great, wonderful passage from the book of Deuteronomy. So Deuteronomy chapter 6, we're going to read the first 9 verses together. So you read with me wherever you are. It says, now this is the commandment, and these are the statutes and judgments which the Lord your God has commanded to teach you, that you may observe them in the land which you are crossing over to possess, that you may fear the Lord your God, to keep all his statutes and his commandments, which I command you, you and your son and your grandson, all the days of your life, and that your days may be prolonged. Therefore hear, O Israel, and be careful to observe it, that it may be well with you, and that you may multiply greatly as the Lord God of your fathers has promised you, a land flowing with milk and honey. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. The Lord is one. You shall love the Lord God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. And these words which I command you today shall be in your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children, and shall talk of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes. You shall write them on the doorpost of your house and on your gates. As I read that tonight, I think about the Lord's instruction through Moses there to the people of Israel, to the nation of Israel, as they're about to enter the promised lands, he gives them some very pertinent information concerning their homes and their families and what they're to do as they enter into the promises of the Lord. I thought about healthy homes tonight is what I want to talk about. Lena and I, we like to watch HGTV, and I'm sure many of you like to also. She likes to watch it a little more than I do. But a few Sunday nights ago, we were watching and we were flipping channels, and we came upon the show that many of us remember from probably the early 2000s, Extreme Home Makeover. And so it's back on. There's a reboot of the program. It began again in February with a new host and a new crew. And as you know, that they make those homes over, they make them often stronger and more spacious and even more spectacular to look at. There's a curb appeal to them, a remodeling and a makeover. And there's a blueprint that they follow. And often you'll see they'll lay that blueprint out on the table there, and there's specific details that they must follow to remake and remodel that house and to do it effectively. That blueprint has a lot of specifics on it, and if they're not followed correctly, it could lead to disaster. As in any remodeling project, before the rebuilding can begin, the home must be examined for stability and for structural integrity. There's often a demolition process that takes place. There's often walls that might be torn down. There are debris that needs to be removed, and things that are worn out or no longer of any value can be discarded to make room for things that actually work. The same is true for our homes. The same is true for our family. The Bible is God's blueprint for our homes and for our lives. The home was God's idea and always has been his idea. And the Lord has given us our families, and the family really is the cornerstone of society. You go all the way back to the beginning of the human race, and in the very beginning of the Bible, the Lord said there, it's not good for man to be alone. So he gave Adam a woman. He brought his wife, Eve, and therefore the home was blueprinted and was made. I'm convinced today beyond a shadow of a doubt that Satan is after the homes in our land. I'm convinced today that for the life of a nation cannot rise above the life of our homes. And so I want to use these words tonight to encourage you in your home life, that we might have healthy homes. From my home to your home tonight, we all need this word of encouragement. I thought about this. Many times we preserve so many things. We preserve animals, and we try to preserve forests and houses. The thing that we can do tonight as believers and in this time is preserve our homes. This season, I think, that the Lord has brought us to may be for that very reason, to preserve our homes and to get back to the way the Lord has intended the home to look. We've been slowed to a standstill. We have had things that often distract us and deter us been removed from our lives, and the Lord's trying to get our attention. I see more walking, as I mentioned before. I see more folks out riding their bikes. Even our own family, we've sat down at the table and we've eaten supper together more often than these days. So the stronger the family is, the stronger a nation will be. And when a family is secure, so is the nation. And I believe the Lord of heaven is trying to secure and steady and stabilize and establish our families, our faith, and even our very future. Moses is giving kind of his farewell address to the nation of Israel before they cross over into the promised land, and God gives him some blueprints tonight that we can follow. In Deuteronomy 6 there, the nation's been wandering for about 40 years in the wilderness. They're on the verge of entering the blessings of God, the land that our scriptures tell us tonight that flows with milk and honey, and so they're getting ready to go into the blessings of the Lord, and he gathers all the families around, husbands and wives and children, possibly by the tens of thousands there, as they gather together on the edge of enemy territory, and he gives them instructions about how to invade and conquer the land. I thought about us tonight and applying that to us. How do we fight the enemy? How do we claim territory that God has promised to us? I would submit to you the same way that Moses tells the nation of Israel to overcome the enemy and claim the land of Canaan there. We live dedicated lives. We trust in a divine Lord, and we follow in some divine lessons and learning processes that he gives them there. I want us to look tonight at these verses and see three things very quickly tonight. And the first thing that we see is that we are to live dedicated lives. There are dedicated lives to be lived. In verses 1 through 3 there, we see some words that are important for us. And in verse 1, he says, "This is the commandment, and these are the statutes and judgments which the Lord your God has commanded to teach you, that you may observe them in the land that you are crossing over to possess." As we read verse 1, there are two times the word commandment there is used. He says commandment, and then he mentions the word commanded. And then again, he says that these are his statutes and his commandments, which I command you. Then in verse 6, we read that word again. "These are the words I command command you today that they shall be in your heart. And so we see that Moses is issuing a command from the Lord. It's something that God wants us to do, desires us to do, and even has commanded us to do. In verse 1, he says that we might observe them. In verse 3, he said, be careful to observe it. And so we're to pay close attention to what the scripture says to us concerning our homes tonight and the instructions that the Lord gave Moses to give to the nation of Israel. We are to live dedicated lives. We are to observe all that God has commanded us and obeyed us and told us to do, and not to live distracted lives, but to live a life that is dedicated to the Lord tonight. Sometimes it's easy to be committed to everything else, and it's easy to give our lives to what really doesn't matter. But what really matters tonight is the Word of God and the will of God and the way that God would have us to go and what He would have us to do. He's given us His Word to love and to live, and so our lives can be blessed. And there's a wonderful promise that is attached to these verses. As we look at verse 2, we read there that he says, we keep these commands and these statutes which I've commanded. And he says, you and your son and your grandson. And he mentions that all the days of your life, you are to keep them, that your days may be prolonged. And so there's a promise attached to keeping the Word of God and what God's asked him to do. I believe obeying the Word of God will prolong your life. If for no other reason, if you obey God's Word and God's will, you won't do something reckless, you won't do something dumb, you won't do something stupid. I've heard a preacher say before that sin will make you stupid, and it will. It'll make you do some dumb stuff. Believe me, I've done enough dumb stuff in my life. Take my word, if you need an authority on doing dumb stuff, you're looking at one tonight. Satan has taken a lot of lives. He has shortened some people's lives, and I believe tonight that some folks would be with us today if they had not given their lives to sin, because they did not obey what God commanded. They did not do what God asked them to do, and they went along with the way that Satan would lead them and the way the flesh would lead them. They gave their lives over to sin, and Satan wrecked their life. And he'll do that in at least three ways. We see that he does it by appealing to the lust of the flesh. We see that he does that by appealing to the lust of the eyes and even the pride of life. And there's no greater illustration of that tonight. As we think about Adam and Eve there in the Garden of Eden, they could have stayed there all the days of their life. They could be there today if it had not been for sin. But sin got them kicked out. And as we read that story, he appealed to Eve and he appealed to the lust of her flesh and the lust of her eyes and the pride of life. And then she turned around and she led Adam that way. And of course, it appealed to him. And so he partook of it too. And I think that Satan created doubt there, that God had their best interests in mind. And that's often where it begins in our life, that Satan creates a doubt that has God said, is it really the best what God has given us and what he has for us? And so doubt begins to creep in. We begin to believe there's another way, and then we quit living that dedicated life like the Lord has asked us to do. I often think, how could they do that in the garden? A perfect place, perfect food. Before the curse of sin came, God walked with them in the cool of the day, and he came and he fellowshiped with them and he talked with Adam. And I just can't help but think, how in the world would they do what they done? But we do the very same thing. The Lord has promised his presence to us. And he said, I'll never leave you and I'll never forsake you. And we have the blessings of God today. And he talks with us and speaks with us. But yet we do the very same thing. We let Satan get in sometimes. And so I want to challenge you and encourage you in these days that we live dedicated lives. I want to read Genesis chapter 3 and begin in verse 1 there. And it talks about that situation there, and I want to show you what I mean, how Satan appealed. It said, the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, God has indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden. And the woman said to the serpent, we may eat the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat it, nor shall you touch it, lest you die. Then the serpent said to the woman, you shall not surely die, for God knows that in the day you eat of it, your eyes will be open, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, he appealed, and it appealed to the lust of her flesh there. She saw it was good for food. It would be satisfying for the flesh. It would be filling for her stomach. He said that it was pleasant to the eyes, and when she saw it was pleasant to the eyes, it appealed. It looked good. It was attractive, and often Satan does the very same thing for us. And he says, and a tree desirable to make one wise. And the old Satan said, you'll know good and evil. You'll be just like God, and it appealed to her pride that you'll know what God knows, that you'll you'll be just like him. And so Satan appealed to Eve in that day. And because of that, it appealed to those three areas that we mentioned a few minutes ago. And he'll do the very same to us today. And so the challenge to live a dedicated life, just like the nation of Israel going into Canaan land, there were many idols and many gods, many distractions, many things that they could have gotten off and followed. And the Lord said, I want you to do this. I want you to do what I'm asking you to do and what I'm commanding you to do, that it may be well with you and that your days may be long and you may be prosperous and you may be blessed. Jesus teaching the parable of the soils in Matthew 13 and verse 22, he said, now he who receives seed among the thorns is he who hears the word, and the cares of this world and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word out and it becomes unfruitful. Mark even adds the desires for other things. So oftentimes in our lives, the cares of the world, the deceitfulness of riches, and really just desires for other things can enter into our life, and they will choke the word out. Be careful. The Bible says Eve took the fruit, and then she gave it. Be careful what we take into our lives, what we allow into our life. Be careful also what we give to others. Sometimes by our actions and our words, we can give other folks things. In other words, we can give them a discouraging word. We can create doubt and fear in their lives. We can create maybe a disgruntled spirit in others. And so we've got to be careful in these days that we live a dedicated life. He goes on. Verse 2 says, that you might fear the Lord your God. The word fear there speaks of a reverential awe. It can relate to our salvation. And I often think about the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. If you want to be wise, then fear the Lord. If you want to have wisdom, then fear the Lord and trust the Lord. Psalm 111 and verse 10, Proverbs 1 and verse 7, Proverbs 9 and verse 10 all tell us about that beginning of wisdom begins with a healthy fear of the Lord, a reverential awe of our God. And it was that reverential awe of the Lord that brought me to salvation. As I read the Word of God and I realized that God is holy, and I realized that I am a sinner, that in light of who He is and who I was, that there was that sin and it was that reverential awe of a holy God that led me to repent and trust Christ. And I pray that you would do that if you've not done it. It also speaks of our sanctification, that we might fear the Lord. The Bible says in Philippians 2 and verse 12, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. It doesn't mean that we work to get it, for salvation is a free gift of God. But as we are saved and as we obey the Lord, we're continually obeying Him, continually seeking to discern His will, to live right and to do right for Him. Because why? We want to honor the Lord and we realize He's holy. And so He says, you fear the Lord. Fear the Lord and keep His commandments and keep His statutes. We've lost, I think, today, in some ways and in many ways, the fear of the Lord. His name is taken lightly. Some use the name of Jesus as an expression of frustration. How many times have we heard someone say, oh, Jesus, and they just seem to be frustrated and they use His name that way. Some use the Lord's name in vain and they put it alongside a swear word. And I'm amazed as we watch television this day, they may bleep some words out or they don't say these, but they'll let the Lord's name be taken in vain. And so we've lost the fear of the Lord in many ways. Jesus is often made fun of. He's often a side joke in sitcoms. Some make fun of His name and His character defiantly, and we need to get back today to a healthy fear of the Lord as believers, and we need to remind folks that God is holy, and we love Him, and we want to honor Him with our lives. I want to share a few verses with you. Proverbs 8 and verse 13 says, the fear of the Lord is to hate evil. And so not to hate the sinner, but to hate the sin, to hate evil. Proverbs 14 and verse 26, in the fear of the Lord, there is a strong confidence. Why? Because we know God is able and we trust Him and we know all things are in His hands. Proverbs 14 and verse 27 says, the fear of the Lord is a fountain of life. I'm thankful that in Him is life, and I'm thankful today that I have eternal life and life that is flowing, a well that is springing up in my life. Proverbs 15 and verse 16 says, better is a little with the fear of the Lord than great treasure with trouble. And so just a little bit in the fear of the Lord is better than anything else tonight. Proverbs 10 and verse 27, the fear of the Lord prolongs days, but the years of the wicked will be shortened. The Bible says there's that promise again, that your days might be prolonged. There's a special blessing for honoring the Lord and honoring His name and honoring His word and His commandments. Look at the other promise there, if you will, in verse 3 with me for just a moment. He says there that it may multiply greatly, that you may multiply greatly as the Lord your God, your fathers has promised you, a land flowing with milk and honey. So the Lord says, your days will be long. But not only that, he said, I'm going to bless you with, I believe, their necessities and even some luxuries in life. He says there, the land flows with milk and honey. It overflows. It's a blessing. It's an overflowing in our life. And God has blessed us. He said, milk and honey. And boy, I like milk and I like honey, especially with peanut butter. Amen. I hope you do too. The Lord says that it was a plenty land. He would meet their needs and he would bless them tremendously in these days for their obedience. My observation has been that the happiest people are those who obey the Lord, who do God's will, who follow his teaching, and who live by the principles of God's word. So our lives, and we are to have dedicated lives that we are to live. Number two, there's a divine Lord that we must love. And he mentions in verse 4, hear, O Israel, the Lord, our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul, with all your strength. And I read those verses tonight, and I think about that wonderful, wonderful passage there. There's only one God. There's the God of the Bible. There's only one Savior, Jesus Christ. There's only one way to heaven. That's by repentance and faith in Jesus Christ. That's it. No other way. There's only one Lord tonight. There's only one God. The word here there is the Hebrew word Shema, and it means to hearken, to listen, to publish. Orthodox Jews would repeat the Shema twice a day. They would repeat this verse 4 there twice a day. And it's considered to be the most important passage in the book of Deuteronomy. And God was telling the nation, he says, hear, O Israel, listen, pay attention, listen up, hearken to what I'm saying. Specifically, he's calling the parents here and to in the home to pay attention. And so to have a healthy home, to live in a land that will be blessed, we need homes that will teach and do and carry out the will of God and the word of God. We need to sit up and pay attention. We need to listen to what God is telling us here and the things that we're seeing all around us and the things that we're hearing. I'm thankful God is patient. I think we see in the words tonight, the Lord is patient. He's speaking today. He's given us time to listen. He says, hear, O Israel, and he's asking you to listen today, that he loves you, that he died for you, that he wants to have a relationship for you. If you know Jesus and you've trusted him, he's speaking to us today, that help us be witnesses in these days. He says, the Lord, our God, he is our personal Savior tonight. And if you know Jesus, you're his and he's yours and he's not distant. He's powerful. Just the very words when I read the Lord has a certain authority to it and a certain power to it. And we know tonight that with the Lord, nothing is impossible. And so we thank the Lord for his great power. He's a proven God. He's proven himself over and over again. And many times in the life of Israel here, he had already proven himself. And in your life, in my life, we know God has proven himself over and over again. He said, you'll love the Lord, or you shall love the Lord with all your heart, all your soul, all your strength. I think the biggest sin in the life of believers in the church today is half-hearted love. Lukewarmness, half-hearted devotion makes God sick. If we read about the church at Laodicea in Revelation 3, we see that. And so the Lord's drawing us back now to a wholehearted love for him. He wants everything about us to love him. Everything about us to be him to be the center of our life. He wants to be first in all we do. And so he gives this great command, the greatest commandment there. And he's allowed tonight the distractions and devotions to be removed that we might focus on him and that our lives might be dedicated living in this day, that we might have a divine Lord that we love. And then lastly, there are some divine lessons that we must learn. We read in verse 6 again, and these words which I command you today shall be in your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children. You shall talk of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up. You'll bind them as signs on your hand, and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes. You shall write them on the doorpost of your house and on your gates. The home is the first classroom. It's the first classroom. Home is where right and wrong is often taught first. It's where children learn that actions have consequences. It's where they learn personal responsibility to be kind and to be courteous. It's where they learn to submit to authority and to be obedient and to practice selflessness. Home is where the two most important lessons that have ever been learned will be learned, and that is this, to love God first and to love each other. And so tonight as we gather in our homes and every day as we gather as families, may we love God first, but also may we be reminded that we're to love others. I read about a father. He was having family devotions one night with his children, and he was teaching them the Ten Commandments. And he got to one of the commandments there, and he said, kids, the commandment says, honor your father and mother. And it's a commandment that teaches you how you are to treat us as your parents. And he paused for a moment and hoping to speak to his children in a way through the scripture. He said, is there a commandment that teaches you how to treat your brothers and sisters? And the little six-year-old boy sat there for a minute, and you could see that the wheels were turning. And he looked back at his dad, and he said, yes, sir, there is. And he said, well, what is it? And he said, thou shalt not kill. And so we know many times in this day, brothers and sisters may be fighting and arguing. We're trying to keep them from killing one another. So take the word of God and encourage them to love one another. So we learned that at home. A Sunday school teacher was talking to his Sunday school class, and he was asking them a question. And he said, why do you love God? And he went down the line as teacher after teacher, or student after student, excuse me, and he began to ask that question. And there were many answers, and there were a lot of variety there. And finally, one little boy sitting on the very end of the row, he called on him, and the little boy said, I don't really know why I love God. I guess it just runs in my family. So, boy, what a blessing that is that many of us can say that loving God came through our family and those who loved us and taught the word of God to us like Moses is commanding the children of Israel. So I rejoice tonight for a family that has loved the Lord and has passed on, and it has ran in my family, so to speak, tonight. And that's what Moses is emphasizing there, the importance of loving the Lord, and that love for him runs in our family for generations to come. He said, you'll love the Lord, you'll teach them diligently to your children. And it's a word that means to sharpen. And we know tonight that as iron sharpens iron, so a man sharpens, brothers sharpen each other. We know that the word of God is sharp tonight. And so we see that it'll sharpen their lives as we teach it and make them ready to meet the challenges of life that they might be undergirded by the foundation of the word of God. He says that they'll talk you shall talk of them when you sit in your house and when you walk by the way, and when you lie down and when you rise up. That's exactly what we've been called to do, to talk about spiritual things and truths just like we talk about everything else. So many other things come so natural, and we do talk about a lot of other things, and those things are good, and I'm sure those things are grand. But the greatest thing we can do is take every opportunity to find and apply truth in our homes today. One verse that I try to teach my children all the time is this: honor your father and your mother, that your days may be long on the earth. That's my favorite verse. I told them when we get that right, we'll move on. Deuteronomy 5:16 talks about that. There's another verse that I think parents, maybe especially during the coronavirus lockdown, are teaching and preaching. And maybe that's found in Philippians 2:14. Do all things without murmuring and disputing. And so we're trying our best in this time, and we're asking the Lord. I don't know if anyone else's PlayStation is lagging, but it is at my house. I don't know if your Wi-Fi is slow, but it is at my house. And so do all things without murmuring, without disputing. All kinds of ways that we can teach our kids and our family and those that we love, maybe even grandchildren and great-grandchildren, as we take these times and as opportunity arises. We can teach them to trust the Lord and to thank God in the midst of difficult circumstances, because we are still truly blessed. We can teach them as they prepare for examinations and as they do online learning. We can teach them to pray and to ask the Lord to help them in this time of frustration, even in their school life. We can teach them that to trust the Lord and to lean on Him and seek Him in relationships. And so it's in these times that we teach them diligently as we sit in our house and we walk by the way, when we lie down and when we rise up. Do it consistently while we're sitting, walking, before bed, in the mornings. There's so much teaching material out there that God has given us. He said, you'll bind them on your hand and as frontlets between your eyes. And the Jews took this literally. They actually took little boxes and they would put them on their foreheads and on their hands. They were called phylacteries, and they would put scripture in them and they would bind them there. And it's just a picture of keeping God's word before them and keeping it close. And so we keep God's word close in these days. It wouldn't hurt for you to put a Bible in your car. I know we all have an extra one somewhere. Put a Bible in your car. And maybe as you're waiting somewhere, or maybe you have to take someone to the doctor, or maybe you're just waiting on something. As school starts back, you're sitting in the parking lot waiting. Just open your Bible up and have it there that you might keep it with you and carry God's word wherever you go. He said to write them on the doorpost of our house and our gates. There's many Jews would put what's called a mezuzah there on their doorpost. And it was another little box they would put there. And it was just a container, again, they would put scripture in. And they would leave it there that wherever they went, in and out of the house, whatever they did, it was a reminder that God's word was there, that it was what they needed in any time and in any day. We're thankful for God's word tonight. I'm thankful this truth. I'm thankful this the authority by which we live by. Joshua 24:15. And if it seems evil to you to serve the Lord, choose for yourselves this day who you will serve, whether the gods of your fathers, whether the gods which your fathers served that were on the other side of the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. May that be our declaration in these days as we just honor the Lord in our homes and as we gather as family. We're to bind the word of God, he said, on their hands. And I think it speaks of actions, what we do. We bind it on our eyes, or there he said they would often put it on their forehead, and I think it speaks of our attitudes and our thoughts. We write it on the doorpost of our house and our very atmosphere. Everything about us ought to just be exemplifying Christ and glorifying him. The others in our neighborhoods must know our house is a house of faith, and we must live it in these days. And so we praise the Lord that we have this great opportunity today. I just pray that everything's going well. Pray these words speak to you. Pray that they encourage you. I'm always thankful that God's word challenges us, convicts us, that it comforts us, that it is instruction for life. And so we pray that these words will be a blessing to you tonight. We hope you know Jesus tonight. And if not, we pray that you'd give your life to him before it's too late. We just ask you to repent of your sins. All you got to do, ask the Lord Jesus into your heart. Say, I want to be forgiven of my sin. Lord, I want you to come live in my heart and my life. And Lord, if you'll do that, Lord, I want to follow you and trust you all the days of your life, of my life. And Romans 10:9 says, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. What a wonderful promise for you and I tonight. If you know Jesus, rejoice. If you don't, give your life to him. May the Lord draw us closer in these days. Let's pray again tonight. Father, thank you again for your word. Thank you, Lord, for the instruction of it. Lord, I pray for every heart and every home. I pray for every family tonight. I pray for every mom and dad. I pray for every young person, our youth and our children. Lord, we pray that, Lord, as we're at home together, that, Lord, you would bless our time tremendously. That, Lord, we could just overcome in these days. Lord, we love you tonight. We thank you for loving us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.